Summary of our result after the first four lectures. It's this phase diagram. This is for hard spheres, and there is an analogous one for solid spheres. So what we did until now was we started by looking at the thermodynamics of the liquid, and we found that the thermodynamics of the liquid is trivial. So the equation of state of the liquid in infinite dimension is just pressure equal to density, okay, in the scaled variables. So here it's inverse pressure versus density. The black line is just 1 over 2 over density. Okay, this is the equilibrium liquid. This was the first lecture. Then in the second lecture we started to look at dynamics of the liquid, and we found that the dynamics is fast in this region, and it relaxes to, it's diffusive at long times. And then there is this dynamical transition at phi equal 4.8 and so on. And above that, the dynamics is arrested, so you have no diffusion in the liquid. And then we said, okay, now let's try to understand this in terms of thermodynamics, what's going on in phase space. And so we introduced the Franz Parisi construction. So we said, okay, we take an equilibrium state in the liquid at some density phi g. And now we try to see, we try to describe this arrested state that we have around it. And we did this by introducing a second copy of the system that is coupled to the first and is exploring ergodically the phase space around the first replica. Okay, and so we had to introduce, we had to make the average of a logarithm, so we introduced replicas to do this average. And we ended up with these blue curves. So the blue curves are the equation of state of glasses. So you can, if you start at phi g, so you are stuck in the glass, you can decompress, and then if you decompress enough, at some point it will melt back into the liquid. Or you can compress, and you can reach the point where pressure diverges, the spheres are just touching each other, and you reach jamming. So this is the situation. However, we made a strong hypothesis to do this calculation, which is that we, in the thermodynamic calculation, we assumed replica symmetry. Okay. So at some point we introduced the replicas to take the average of the log, and we said, okay, the free energy is symmetric under permutation of these replicas. So if this symmetry is not broken, then we had a matrix DAD, which was the mean square displacement between the replicas. Okay, let's use the scaled version, delta AB, which is D times this. Anyway, and we assume that this matrix delta AB was independent, the matrix elements were independent of A and B, okay? So under this this assumption, so this was the assumption on the side of the thermodynamics of the thermodynamic construction, and on the side of the dynamics, we assumed that all the correlation functions, for example, the memory function, has a fast part and then a plateau. Okay, so this is in terms of, if you want, in terms of replicas, you can write that this matrix is delta times 1 minus delta AB, and this is the Kronecker delta because it's 0 on the diagonal. And on the side of the dynamics, we are saying that the mean square displacement delta of t has a fast part, and then it goes to a plateau delta infinity, and delta infinity is the same delta here. Okay, and this is fast. This time scale is fast. Fast, I mean it's fine. It's going, let's say, exponentially to the plateau. So we had these two assumptions on the two sides, and I told you that this is going to be correct as long as there is no phase transition between the initial preparation point and the point at which you are going to follow the glass. And so, if there is no phase transition, then you expect to converge fast to the stationary state. You also expect concentration over y. Y is the reference configuration at the initial state. And you also expect that there is no history dependence. So if you do the quench from here to here very fast, let's say instantaneously, or slowly, or first you decompress and then compress, I mean, you can do what you want, but if the system is exploring ergodically the glass basin, then the result at long times, once you stop and you stay at a given point for a long time, then you reach the same pressure independently of what you did before. Is this fine? Okay. So if this is fine, now we can see what happens if this assumption is broken. So the problem can come precisely from this replica symmetry. And okay, so I'm going to discuss what happens when it's broken. Just one, so we're going now to discuss replica symmetry breaking, the Gardner transition. So this is discussed in chapter 5 and 6 of the book, and I am going to do it very shortly, because replica symmetry breaking has a lot of interesting physics and mathematics, but it's quite complicated and it would take me a lot of time. So I will just give you a sketch of the main ideas without any calculation. And if you are interested in the calculations, you can check the book. And also, I mean, you can check also the book of Mézard, Parisi and Virasoro, which is the classic introduction to replica symmetry breaking. And there are many other books, of course. Now, what you can do, so you know, if you have a ferromagnetic system, you have a free energy function of M, which is even under the change of sign of M, and you can have a phase transition if the local minimum in zero is destabilized. So what do you do to detect this? You compute F second in zero, right? If F second in zero is positive, so I don't know, you call it lambda. If lambda is positive, then the minimum in zero is a stable state. If it's negative, it becomes linearly unstable, and you expect then to have minima at M star and minus M star, so the inversion symmetry is spontaneously broken. So here you have to do exactly the same thing. So we wrote the free energy of the glass in terms of this matrix delta AB. Okay? And you remember to be precise that delta AB has this shape. There is zero on the diagonal because it's the mean square displacement of a replica with itself. Then there is delta R on the first line and the first column. So this is the constraint that the replicas that describe the followed state are coupled to the reference replica. So this is fixed, you cannot change it. And then there is this delta AB here. So you have replica symmetry in this block. So you have in total N replicas, and you have replica symmetry in a block of S replicas, where S is N minus 1. So what you have to do, at each S, you have to diagonalize the second derivative. So you have to write the matrix of second derivatives. This is an object with four indices, A, B, C, D. And you have to look, so you have to compute it in delta A, B. So this is now, I'm doing it only in the block of N minus one replicas. Then you have to compute it in delta A, B equal to delta times one minus delta A, B, let's say in the replica symmetric solution. So it's the same you do here. You do the second derivative, you compute it in the paramagnetic point, and you look if it's stable. Except now this is a matrix, so it will have many eigenvalues. The point is that because F is symmetric, it's a replica symmetric, so you take the second derivative and you compute it in a replica symmetric point. So this matrix M, A, B, C, D is simple, actually. You can show that it has only three independent elements, M1, M2, M3. This is using the symmetries. So you have three eigenvalues, okay? Okay, and then there is one of these three eigenvalues that is known to be the one responsible for the breaking. So you compute this eigenvalue and you check if it's stable or not. The point is that, so the important point I wanted to make here is that since you can write everything in terms of three eigenvalues that depend on S, so you have lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3. So at each S you do this, but because you are computing everything in a replica symmetric point, these are explicit function of S. So then you can send S to 0, which is what we have to do. So you send S to 0 and you get the eigenvalues at S to 0 and you check if they are positive or negative. So if you do this, yes.
What's the idea behind having only three eigenvalues?
The idea?
Why are there only three independent eigenvalues?
It's just mathematics. You look at the symmetries of the matrix and you realize that there is. So if you want the eigenvectors are a function of A, B, but they must be symmetric. So essentially you can have either the constant eigenvector or an eigenvector that has like sum over B is independent of A. I mean, you can, I don't remember the detailed thing, but you can classify the eigenvectors under the symmetry. And anyway, I mean, it's a very easy calculation. You see that the matrix has these three things and then you can diagonalize it. I don't think there is a physical underlying. So you have these eigenvalues and you can compute them. And I mean, the point is that now these eigenvalues are only, you do the limit as to 0 and you get these eigenvalues, and the eigenvalues are functions of the replica symmetric calculation. So the only thing you have to do is to solve the replica symmetric equations on this line, and at each point you compute the eigenvalues, like you do here, and you have to compute the magnetic susceptibility in the paramagnetic phase, and you have to check what happens. So what you find if you do this is that you have a transition. So I told you that this spinodal point was unphysical, because you expect that if you compress a state, you can compress it without destabilizing it. And indeed, if you take into account replica symmetric breaking, you find that there is a point here. For each state, there is a point where the symmetry is broken, and it makes something like this. So you have a line. Now the line starts from phi d. So you have a line like this, and this is the RSB line or Gardner line. So this is called. So yesterday Olivier introduced already the Gardner transition. So this is called Gardner transition because it was discovered first in spin glass, in the p-spin glass model, by Elizabeth Gardner in 1985. Good. So okay, I told you this line goes to the dynamical transition. By the way, also the other line, the spinodal line, I mean the melting line here, goes into the dynamical transition. So when you are at the dynamical point, you are just marginally stable, so you are, if you try to perturb a little bit the glass, typically you destroy it, okay? Good, what happens, we will discuss in a second what happens at densities bigger than the Gardner point, but what happens when you approach the Gardner point? So you are still in a replica symmetric phase. So let's say you start here and now you start to compress your glass and you look at what happens to the dynamics. And what you can show is that the dynamics becomes critical. Exactly, I told you when you approach this point, the dynamical transition from below, the mean square displacement was doing, so you have here a time, tau. And what happens is that the mean square displacement, delta minus delta t, at the critical point goes like t to the minus a, and otherwise it's something like t to the minus a times the exponential of minus t over tau, where tau is phi, let's say delta phi to the minus a. Sorry, 1 over 2a. And a is the mod coupling exponent. I wrote the relation on the blackboard the other day and now I forgot it. It's gamma. It depends on this parameter lambda. So, lambda is not the eigenvalue, okay? It's another thing. Let's call it lambda MCT. So you have in the glass, when you approach the Gardner transition, you have critical dynamics. So the hypothesis of fast relaxation breaks because you are approaching the critical point. So this Gardner transition is really a kind of second order phase transition inside the glass. So you have critical dynamics, and also you have you can look to the long time limit of the 4-point function in the glass, and this will diverge, and I think it's delta phi to the minus 1/2. Okay. I'm not completely sure, I don't remember, but okay, I think it's minus, it's the same as should be the same as on the other side. Anyway, so you have critical dynamics and you have a divergent susceptibility in the glass when you approach this point. What happens below this point? We would like to know what happens if we continue to compress. The problem is that, if you go beyond the Gardner point, now this equivalence between statics and dynamics is broken. Okay, so you don't know exactly, you can do what you can do. So let's first describe. So if you insist in doing Franz Parisi calculations beyond the Gardner point, what do you think? What do you find? So what you find is a replica symmetry broken solution. So you have a solution where delta AB is not symmetric. So you have in your matrix, you have in the block of n minus one replica, you have an untrivial form. And so this means that replicas are not equivalent, okay? Now, of course, the free energy is symmetric. So for any non-trivial solution, you also the solution where you make a permutation of line and columns is also a solution. But it's a broken state, so you have to fix one of them. Like in the ferromagnetic case, you have two solutions, m star and minus m star, and you have to choose one. So let's choose one. And what you can do is... I'm sorry, I'm switching from D to delta continuously, but... So D is the one infinite D and delta is the one scaled in infinity. Let's use delta. So what you can do is you can introduce a probability distribution of delta.
You say non-trivial, but does it have any particular form?
Yes, but I don't want to enter into that. Yes, it has a very precise form that is fixed by some algebraic structure, but this would take two free lectures to do it properly, so... So yes, it has a very specific form. It's called the Parisi hierarchical matrix, and it satisfies some specific structure. So from this you can introduce this P of delta. So P of delta is essentially, you can show exactly because of this form that you can introduce a probability distribution over replicas. If you want, it's something like 1 over, you have S replicas, is something like this. So you make an histogram over all the replicas, of their distances, okay? And you can show that because of this structure, you can take the limit S to zero, and this has a good limit in the S to zero limit. So the important point is that this thing looks like that. You have two delta peaks in delta minimum and delta maximum, and then you have a continuous part. And then it's zero outside. So what does this mean? So you can interpret this as a description of a very complex landscape. So the idea is that, so this is the sketch that Olivier showed yesterday. So in the stable glass, you have just one basin. You have your initial state y, and then the replicas are going to be essentially independently distributed inside this glass, okay? And so you have delta r is the typical distance between y and any of the x, and then you have delta, which is the mutual distance between any pair of replicas. And they are, all the replicas are independently moving into this glass basin. So this is a sketch of, this is a sketch of phase space, okay? So it's very misleading because it's a high-dimensional space, but okay. We have these blobs in phase space where the replicas are moving ergodically. When you are instead in this beyond the Gardner point, the idea, I mean the interpretation of this, is that your glass is, it has structure, so you have sub-glasses. And so y is always somewhere, it's always selecting your initial state, but then the replicas will explore this structure, but they don't, for example, they can be in the same sub-basin or they can be in different sub-basins, and once they are there, they are trapped, and they are exploring this structure. So you, here you see that you have, for example, here you have two values. You have delta 1, let's say, that is the size of this, and you have delta 2, that is the size of that is the distance between two of these things. So in this situation, if you make an histogram of the distances between the replicas, you would get some replicas at distance delta 1, some other replicas at distance delta 2, and this probability would have two peaks. I'm not taking into account delta r, which is fixed. But so instead, p that has two delta peaks, but there is also this continuous part. So the continuous part means that there is more structure. It's more complicated than just one. So you have other blobs inside each of them, and so on. Okay, and you have a continuous distribution of distances between your replicas. So this means that this structure is kind of distributed with many, many states into states into states. Okay, I know it's not satisfactory, but that's the best I can do in reasonable time, and I didn't want to give a series of lectures on RSB because it's not, I think, the main topic of the school. So we have this complex landscape, and you can be very precise on the distribution of the states, and you can read chapter 5 if you want. We have this P of delta. Now the problem is, what is dynamics going to do? So we can solve for this P of delta, which is the order parameter of the replica symmetry Brogan state. So we have equations for this P of delta that we can derive from we have our Fg of delta AB. So we plug this Parisi structure inside, and essentially it becomes a function of a function, so it's a functional. This function delta of x is just related to p, so p is dx over d delta. So this delta of x is just, if you want, is the inverse of the primitive of p. Anyway, they are related. P of delta and delta of x are related. So you get this functional, and then you have to optimize the functional. And this gives you an equation for delta of x. So it's not a very complicated equation. You can solve it numerically. The numerical solution is not totally trivial, but it's doable. And if you solve the equations, you can compute the pressure, for example. So you can continue these lines, and you can go up to jamming. Except in the vicinity of 5D, there is some problem in the code. And honestly, I don't know what's going on. But OK, at least if you start deep enough, it's fine. So this is what happens if you prepare an equilibrium configuration here, and you insist that you want to be in equilibrium here with this one, just only with the constraint that the distance between this configuration and this configuration is fixed. And then you minimize over delta R2. The problem is that there is a phase transition, so we have no guarantee that the dynamics is going to equilibrate at this point. Okay, so so then you can run dynamics, and I think this is really work in progress. So if you have discussed with Gianpaolo about his work and his poster, what he's doing is to prepare states. He's doing it in the p-spin, so the plot is reversed, it's temperature and energy, but it's the same idea. I mean, he's preparing states at different initial temperatures, above and below, but we are now interested in what's happening below. And he's doing quenches. And OK, it's not clear what the dynamics is doing at long times, I would say. I think it's really not clear if it's going to equilibrate on this RSB solution or not. So this is an open problem, but at least what we can see, what we can say is that in the vicinity of the Gardner point, the dynamics will become non-trivial. So you have this divergent time scale, this divergent susceptibility, and beyond it, you expect to have some kind of aging inside the glass, and then maybe eventually at very long times you could reach something that looks like this full RSB state, but it will take a long time because the time is divergent here. Okay. So I would say that what we can predict from the theory at this stage is that when we approach the Gardner point, we have a divergent time scale, a divergent four-point correlation, which is chi4, aging just below and just beyond, let's say. It's below if it is in temperature and above if it is in density, and a complex landscape. So the system is moving in, yes?
Sorry, from the histogram you just erased, like you mentioned that there are two peaks. Why not the biggest value of delta? Is that biggest value of delta related to, let's say, delta 2 there? I mean, you expect
delta? Related to
delta
what?
Delta 2, in the there.
Yes. It so in the if there is no green stuff, if it's just one group of clusters inside the big one, then this is called the one step replica simply broken state, and there are just two deltas. So one would be the size of a state, and the other would be the distance between states. And this would be delta minimum and delta maximum. And you would not have the continuous part.
Yeah, but then the delta minimum wouldn't be the distance inside a smaller basin?
Yes.
Okay. So, but then the two peaks is not delta 1 and delta 2, because there's something smaller than delta 1, right?
No, delta 1 is the typical distance between two replicas that are in the same red blob.
Yeah, exactly. But then that's not the minimum peak. Because then you
it's not the smallest, it's not the left part of the histogram. No, they are smaller delta than this one.
The continuous part is not the green blob. drops you draw, but it's something between the size of the red and the size of the black. The red is the minimum, and the black is the maximum.
Wait a second.
The green is in between, so it's a structure.
What? No, delta 2 is the size of the black.
And delta 1 is the size of the red.
Yes.
So something in between must be larger than the red and smaller than the black.
But no, I'm sorry, okay.
Sorry,
I mean delta 2...
Okay,
wait, let's do it properly. Okay, if I have just one RSB, what do I have? P of delta, I have two peaks. Okay, so one peak is the size... let's not give them names, but just... So we have two peaks. If you want one peak, the biggest peak is the size of the black. And the smallest peak is the size of the red. Are you fine with this? Maybe it's my notation that isn't confusing, but... So if I introduce... This is one step replica symmetry breaking. If I introduce that there are green ones, I will have another peak. If now there are purple ones, I will have another peak.
Yeah.
So there is always a delta minimum and a delta maximum. The delta minimum is the size of the smallest state. The delta maximum is always the size of this. And in between there are other deltas. And the point is that you have to take a continuum limit where this delta will accumulate and create a continuous structure.
Okay.
Fine? Okay, sorry if I was confusing. Yes?
If I remember correctly, delta minimum in Sherry-Tokitak model is...
Delta minimum?
In Sherry-Tokitak is connected with magnetic field, no?
Yes.
Here in this case,
it's connected to the magnetic susceptibility inside the state.
Okay.
In this one,
in
the
SK.
So in the SK, the magnetic susceptibility, the linear magnetic susceptibility, sorry, chi magnetic, which is not the chi there. So this is beta times 1 minus Q, I think. Mm-hmm. Where Q is Q minimum. And okay, you can see that maybe at the end I could quickly discuss that in this case delta minimum is going to be the shear modulus. So in the Sherry-Tokitak model, when you have this structure, you have a distribution of magnetic susceptibilities because you have the magnetic susceptibility of the smallest state, but then if you let the system explore a little bit more, you will relax a little bit it's what I was describing in the questions and answers session. The system will relax a bit more, will explore a bit more, and you lower the magnetic susceptibility. So you have a chi of x. And in this case, you can do the same with a shear. If you shear the system, at the beginning you have the response of the green thing, and this will be 1 over delta minimum. If you let it go a little bit more, you will lower and you have 1 over delta of x. So you have a distribution of shear moduli. But maybe we can discuss this later. Yes?
But if we are trapped in a green blob for an infinite time, what is the sense of the red blob?
Yes, that's exactly the problem. So the problem is that this is a static picture. This is, if you want, a characterization of the free energy landscape around this y. So you take a y, you look around it, you do an equilibrium calculation around it, and you find that the landscape is complex. But now if I start from... So the reason I introduced all this thing is that I wanted to describe the dynamics that starts from y. Right? So if I start from y and run dynamics, how am I going to explore this thing? That's the question. And it's an open question, to be fair. I mean, I don't know. There are some cases, so maybe this is the last thing I wanted to stress. So I will maybe come back on this later, because, I mean, if you have replica symmetry breaking in equilibrium, like in the Sherry-Tokitak model, you have really an equilibrium replica symmetry breaking state, then you know that if the dynamics satisfies the tail balance, eventually it will go to equilibrium. So if you wait long enough, you will go to equilibrium. Long enough might be exponential in n, but at least you know that at very long times you are going to go to this landscape. The problem is that here we are not doing full equilibrium, we are doing a constrained equilibrium. So our state, we should not never forget that this state is globally metastable. We are selecting, you remember that the Franz-Parisi potential has a local minimum. So this is all this discussion. So this is delta R, and we are looking to the shape of the thing around delta R. So we cannot say, if we wait an exponential time in N or in D, eventually we will go to this equilibrium, because eventually we will escape the basin and go somewhere else. So this is why the problem is non-trivial. So I think Gianpaolo has the tools to explore this, and it will be done, but I think there is a lot of stuff to understand about what the out-of-equilibrium dynamics is doing here. Does this answer you? So that would be the end of the RSB part. Okay. Yes.
Does this approach tell us something about the heights of the barriers?
I mean, you can try to do something. I mean, there is work ongoing where you try to use more complicated replica schemes to understand the shape of barriers. For example, Giulio and Chiara have been working on it, and also Giorgio Parisi with Andrea Cavagna. So you can put, I mean, you can try to constrain the replicas, like you put one replica here and you constrain another one to be here, and you look at the potential in between to try to understand the barriers. So yes, you can get some information about barriers from modified replica approaches.
And you think they might be exponential in N?
So, okay, let's say if you stop at a given stage in this hierarchical construction, then since you are in field, the barriers are always going to be of order N in energy, so the time is always going to be exponential in N. Okay. When you send the number of breaking to infinity, then it's more complicated, because then the states become marginal. This is something that I didn't discuss but I mean, you can show that in this limit you have a zero eigenvalue always in the states. So they are not minimum of the free energy, but they have a flat direction. So probably the barriers are lower than N. And in the SK model, I think people believe it's N to the 1/3 or something like that. But all these are open problems. And so I don't have a firm answer. So there is also a lot of numerical work going on the barriers and the structure of the landscape. So Ludovic has a paper with Kini Liao. We have a paper with Kimi and Ludovic. So there is a lot of, I mean, one can try to do numerics and explore the barriers in this landscape, and you can get information. It seems that there is a wide distribution of sizes of barriers and. I don't know if Ludovic is going to say something on this, but probably not. No. Okay. So you can check. I can put papers in the Dropbox and you can ask me questions and we can discuss offline. Okay. If there is no other question, I think I will stop here with the RSB. I mean, once again, I'm not doing much more, because I would start waving a lot of my hands, I would start talking about things that are not very well understood, and maybe this is not the best thing to do in a lectures. But I mean, there are many research papers on this. And now,
what's the situation with time?
Okay. Okay, now I would like to go a little bit deeper in density and see and see what happens. I mean, up to, I mean, I told you that you can compress your system and then you can get stuck at some point and fall a glass, but up to where? I mean, can you go to as large densities as you want or not? I mean, intuitively you cannot, because you know that the density is bounded. I mean, you cannot, these are hard spheres, you cannot compress them as much as you want. So in order to understand this, we have to introduce the Monasson method. And we have to evaluate the complexity. So this is chapter 7 in the book. And so we are going to start by revising a little bit what we did in equilibrium. Okay? So section 7.1 is the equilibrium complexity. So, okay, what we did in equilibrium, so I'm back to phi t equal to phi t tg. So I will prepare a state, I'm going to focus on the black line. I will prepare a state at some density, and I will compute the properties of the state at the same density. So we know that in this case, replica symmetry is never broken, so we can keep the replica symmetric result. And what I told you, so we got the free energy of the liquid. So the free energy of the liquid is given by d over 2 log of 2 pi e over d plus d pi over 2 integral h e to the h times e to the minus beta d bar of h minus 1. This is the free energy of the liquid, and then you have an order 1 correction. So I just kept the leading terms in d. I have a log d term, and I have a d term, and I have an order 1 term. So this is what we got from the truncation of the virial to order 2. And then we did the glass calculation, so we got the glass free energy, and the glass free energy is d over 2 log pi e delta over d squared plus d over 2 plus d pi hat. Then we have this function q log q. Plus order 1. So let's forget about the order 1. And so this is the result we got from the Franz Parisi calculation, and then we have to minimize this over delta. So now I'm assuming that delta is already minimized. And you remember that delta is equal to delta r in this case. We discussed it several times. So the other, so this is, okay, so we have the free energy of the liquid and we have the free energy of the glass. And also we can derive from this that the energy of the liquid is equal to the energy of the glass. And also the pressure of the liquid is equal to the pressure of the glass, and so on. But in particular, the energy. So at this point, we should remember that the glass and the liquid are not coexisting phases, okay? We didn't... So what we did, if you remember, I mean, the picture we have in mind is that the liquid is made of many glasses. And the way to see this is to plot f of delta, and I told you f of delta is something like this. So we took the local minimum in order to confine the system in a glass, but if we let delta go to infinity, then we recover the liquid free energy. Okay, so this is fg, this is delta star, if you want, and this is f liquid. Just one little technical thing before you get confused. If you take the limit delta to infinity of this expression, you don't get the liquid free energy, and this is because of a nasty problem of limits of exchange of limits. So this expression is correct if you take d to infinity and let's say the thermodynamic limit at finite delta. Otherwise, it's a bit more complicated. So you can fix this, but just formally, this thing will not go to the right limit because you see you have a log delta that is going to diverge. You will not get this, but the point is that here there is a break if you want. And if you want to describe this part, you have to take the limit in a way. And if you want to describe this other part, you have to. But anyway, this will not affect the results. So you have the free energy of the liquid and you have the free energy of the glass, of one of these glasses. And we know that the energy of the two states is the same. The reason why the energy is the same is, again, that the glass is just a portion of the liquid. So we took equilibrium configurations y. We took configurations x that are close to y, and they should have the same energy because they are in the same state. So what is this? So, but these two things are different. So since the free energy is equal to E minus TS, where S is the entropy, the difference in free energy, since the energies are equal, must be a difference in entropy. Okay. And what is this difference in entropy? Is just the number of states of glasses that you can have. So this delta F here is minus T delta S, and this delta S is called sigma equilibrium. So this is a function of phi and T, and we will interpret this sigma equilibrium of phi and T as 1 over n times the logarithm of the number of states that we have at point phi and T. Okay, so this entropy is counting how many equivalent glasses you have in equilibrium. And then we can get an expression for sigma, which is, so I just take the difference of these two, but I have to erase them because I don't have space. Maybe I can write it up there. So sigma is going to be d over 2 log d minus d over 2 minus d over 2 log delta over 2 plus d phi hat over 2 times the integral over h of e to the h, and then you have e to the minus beta d minus 1 minus q log q. So this is the expression for the equilibrium complexity. And delta is always the one you get from the minimization. So the reason I brought it explicit is that you see it has a strange scaling with D. So the, okay, it diverges as D log D. So we can plot this, you cannot plot it for d to infinity because you have two different terms with two different scalings. One is d log d and the other is d. But if you fix d, I don't know, you put d equal to 50 or d equal to 100, you can plot sigma, for example, for R spheres, and it will have this shape. So, by the way, all this calculation makes sense only if we are above phi d, right? Because below there are no states, so there is no solution for delta. So below phi d there are no states, so I cannot count anything. And when I reach phi d, this thing will jump to some number, and then it goes down, and at some point it goes to zero. So when it goes to zero, what happens? It means that the number of states is not exponential, and if you continue, formally it would become negative. So since the number of states is the exponential of n times sigma, if sigma is negative, then it means that something is wrong. I mean, there is an exponentially small number of states, so there are no states. Okay? So this is the Kauzmann transition that Ludovic introduced. And this tells you that even if formally the liquid exists, in reality the liquid is broken in all these glasses, and above this point there are no glasses, so the liquid doesn't exist anymore above this point. It doesn't make sense to consider the liquid as a state. So this will put an end to our liquid equation of state. Okay? And above this point, there is no liquid anymore. Now, what is the behavior of phi k? So you can show, so essentially, if you want, in order to compensate for this log d term, you see you have d log d, and you have d, and you have a phi here. So in order to compensate, and you have a delta here, so in order to compensate for this log d, what you need is phi to be large. So essentially you need phi of the order of log d. And what you can show us is that when phi is large, then delta is of the order of 1 over phi. So you take this solution, you put it in the complexity. You see that delta going as 1 over phi means it goes like 1 over log d. But it is in a log, so it gives a log d correction that you can drop. And so essentially, at the leading order, you get d log d over 2 plus d phi over 2. And then you can work a little bit with this integral. And when delta is going to 0, you can show that this is this is e to the minus beta v times 1 plus beta v minus 1. So, and this should be 0 to fix the Kauzmann transition. So you get that phi k is equal to log d divided by a function g k of beta. And the function is just this integral. With a minus. So why am I doing this explicitly? It's because you can show very easily that this function is 1. There is an exponential of h. There is always an exponential of h next to the h. So why I don't have it in my notes? I think I forgot to copy it. You take the equation for delta. Delta is defined by the minimization of the free energy. You take the equation for delta and you see that it goes like that. Which is kind of intuitive. When you increase the density, the size of your glasses becomes smaller. So, if you take our spheres, you see that v is equal either to 0, and then this function is 0, or to infinity. So when v is infinity, this is minus 1. So you have to integrate between minus infinity and 0 the exponential of h, so you get 1. So for our spheres, you get phi k precisely equal to log k to log d, plus you have corrections of the order of log d. Okay? For soft spheres, so soft spheres was the potential e to the minus 4h, which corresponds to the one that Ludovic used. that is the 1 over r to the 12 potential, okay, in three dimensions. So for soft spheres, what happens is that this function goes like beta to the 4. So what you get is that tk, if you fix the density to 1, for example, and you invert this, you get tk of the order of 1 over log d to the 4. So you see, it widens with d. When you increase the dimension, phi d is finite, and phi k goes to infinity slowly, but it goes to infinity. And when you do it for soft spheres, you have, if you fix the density in such a way that td is equal to 1, then tk will go to 0 as 1 over log. Yes? So
maybe I missed something, but why doesn't the integral diverge in case b of h goes to infinity?
Because, so if h is positive, you have v equal to 0, and you get 1, 1, minus 1.
Okay.
So it's 0.
Yeah.
If v is infinity,
yeah,
then this thing is 0. You get minus 1.
Yeah.
So you get minus integral between minus infinity and 0 dh of e to the h.
Yeah, yeah.
And this is 1.
Okay.
It's minus 1.
The infinity was in there. No, okay.
It's there.
Yeah.
Yes. No, that's why I was... That's why I added the e to the h that I forgot. Otherwise, it's not. Okay, so what happens for more general potential? So we have hard spheres and we have soft spheres. What we can do is also to look at WCA, which is another widely used potential. So WCA is the potential V of R equal to 1. So you have, it's a Lennard-Jones that you truncate and shift. So it's something like this. You put 1 over r to the 12 repulsion, and you put 1 over 6 attraction, and there is a factor somewhere, 2. And this is for r smaller than l, and otherwise it's 0. So it's like this, right? V of r. So you have repulsive spheres, like the one that Andrea considered, but you have a divergent repulsion. So they are, you have a kind of R core. So in the language of infinite dimension, this becomes epsilon times 1 plus e to the minus 4h minus 2 e to the minus 2h times theta of minus h. So for this potential, what you get in the phase diagram is you have two lines. If you do phi and t, you have a dynamical transition. So at zero temperature, this reduces to the hard spheres. So you have, here is the phi d of hard spheres. And then you have a line td of phi. So here it's liquid. Then you have phi k of hard spheres, which is of the order of log d. And you have, again, you have a line like this. So here you have an arrested liquid. And above this line, we have to discuss what happens, but you have no liquid, okay? So the liquid stops to exist at this line, tk. And tk is a function of phi over log d. So this line will shift to the right when I increase dimension. The reason I show this is that later I want to come back on this point, that if you take a system at density at any finite phi and you cool, you don't. So if you, let's make some space. If you take such a system and you fix a finite density and you cool, you will meet the dynamical transition at some point. You enter the arrested liquid, but the Kautzmann transition, when this is large, is there. So you don't have any Kautzmann transition in temperature. So this is, I will come back to this, but this is just because people tend to think, in midfield there is always a Kautzmann transition. It's not the case. There are many potentials for which you don't have any Kautzmann transition. The complexity is finite at zero temperature. So just for you to keep in mind that when people say, ah, if there is no Kassmann transition, then in field is wrong. So mean field is more about metastability than about Kautzmann. Kautzmann is a kind of accident, if you want to say.
See, this is still in liquid space, right? This is a liquid.
Here?
Yeah.
Here, if I prepare a state...
Where is the
if I prepare a state somewhere here,
okay,
and I run the dynamics, I'm in equilibrium, but the dynamics is arrested. So it's the same as our spheres on this line. And then I can decide, so I fix a state, so this... So Camille did that. You can fix a state here, Tg, phi g. You are in equilibrium. You run your equilibrium dynamics and it's arrested, like it's here. And then you can decide to compress or decompress the state out of equilibrium and see what happens. So this is the equilibrium phase diagram, if you want it. I have a liquid, I have an arrested liquid. I have Kautzmann. Here, I have to discuss what happens. And here, what happens is that I can prepare equilibrium states, and they are arrested, and then I can follow them in the phase space. Ah, thanks.
No.
I can. Yes, it's a non-ergodic.
I'm confused here. Since it's not in contact with liquid, so why is equilibrium state?
So yes, exactly. So this is all the point. So the point is that in mean field, you can have situations where you prepare a state in equilibrium, and then you run the dynamics, and you discover that the dynamics is arrested. Now you could say, okay, but then if dynamics is arrested, how can I prepare this equilibrium state? So this is the discussion I made. You can do swap.
Okay.
So you swap.
But in this case, you could still use fluctuation dissipation theorem?
Yes. Fluctuation dissipation theorem is going to work in this phase for the short time dynamics. But then you have a plateau and you don't have diffusion. So you can do swap, or you can imagine that you have a very powerful computer. You do exponentially small cooling rate in D. So you wait a time exponential in D. Then you can equilibrate up to here. And now you take the configuration and you put it on a normal computer that does finite time, not exponential in D. And then you compress and decompress, and the dynamics is completely stuck. So it's again, it's this idea of separation of time scales. Okay? Good. So we discussed the equilibrium complexity. Now so this is what Ludovic focused on, right? So you have this Franz Parisi potential. The Franz Parisi potential is a local minimum. So I'm doing in delta, but Ludovic did it in Q. So you have a local minimum that is the glass, and you have the absolute minimum that is the liquid. And the difference is the contribution that comes from the number of glasses that you visit, that you can visit in equilibrium. So the next step I want to take is to study what happens beyond the Kautzmann point. Because you could say, okay, now I got here, I'm in equilibrium, and now there are the number of states, that the number of glasses is exponential everywhere here. When I reach the Kautzmann point, I have e to the n sigma with sigma equal to 0 states, so it's order 1 states, or maybe order n to some power. So, I mean, you can show that with probability 1, you have a finite number of states. So and then you can say, if I keep compressing, because here the pressure is finite, so if the pressure is finite, it means I can still compress. If I keep compressing, what happens? What can I do? So for this, we need to study the distribution of states and what kind of states are available at this point. So this is the Monasson method out of equilibrium, in a sense that I will make more precise. So this is section 7.2, Monasson, the Monasson method, let's see. The Monasson method and the complexity. So let's erase this. So okay, what's the idea? I think Ludovico already introduced it, but okay, I think at least for me when I was a student, the Monasson method was a bit hard to digest. So I think, and every time when I teach them classes, I always find that people find it a bit hard to digest. So I will, even if Ludovico already introduced it once, I will do it another time. So and you stop me if you have questions, of course. So this is phase space again, and there are states, okay? And I will label the states by alpha. So alpha equal 1, 2, 3, these are the states. And let's assume, which is essentially correct, that each configuration x, so this is the space of all x, and I say, okay, each configuration x can be attributed to one state. So in reality, these states are probability distributions. They will have tails, and maybe there are some states here that you don't know exactly how to treat, but essentially this is correct. So I will say, okay, each configuration can be belong to one state. Then now I take the liquid partition function. This is the integral of e to the minus beta v of x, right? And then I can decompose it. I can say, okay, this is an integral over all the space, but I will write it as a sum over the states and an integral over configurations that belong to state alpha of e to the minus beta v of x. Okay? So if each configuration belongs to only one state, then I can decompose things in this way. And then I will call this integral, the partition function of state alpha. I will call this z alpha. And since it is a partition function, it is the exponential of minus beta n times the free energy of state alpha. So I define f alpha as minus t over n log of z alpha. Okay? This is something that, for example, people who study potential energy landscapes can do and have done. And what they do is they identify each state with a minimum in the landscape. And then they say the configuration X that belongs to state alpha are all the configurations that, when you minimize the energy, will fall into this minimum. This is an approximation because, in reality, you have to work with probability distributions, but it's a decent one. So. Okay, and so then this is sum over alpha of e to the minus beta n f alpha. Okay, so now I can introduce the density of states. I will say I call n of f and phi and t the number of states that have free energy f. So I'm working, an important thing is that I'm working at a given state point now, okay? I fix density and temperature, and I look to my system. And so this object counts how many states of free energy F I have at a given state point. And I'm going to assume that this object is exponential in N. So it is the exponential of N times F and phi T. Okay, because I mean we have seen that in equilibrium there are an exponential number of states, so it's natural. And this sigma of f. So the point is that if you want, until now, we looked only at one class of states that are the typical states. So what I was doing before was to fix a state point, look to the equilibrium. I said okay. If I select an equilibrium configuration, this configuration falls in a state. So maybe I can do a drawing a bit better. So what we said before was, okay, I take an equilibrium configuration in this space, and this will fall into a cluster, into a state. So I have states. And I have an exponential number of them. What I want to do now is a bit more, because I want to, so all these states have the same free energy. That was my assumption, right? That the free energy that a priori, so I have y, and I had the free energy of y, of the state of y, but I was assuming that this is equal to fg, which is the average over y. So I was assuming that the fluctuations from state to state are very small, which is true if I take states at random with the equilibrium measure, but there are many other states. There are states that are bigger, there are states that are smaller. So these states, the blue ones, are such that if I take at random a configuration with the distribution in equilibrium, I will never see them. They are rare, okay? But I want to take them into account for a reason that you will see in a second. So now this sigma of f is, I fix a state point phi t, and I look to how many states I have at a given free energy, and I take into account all the states. And so the typical one, so if you want, the equilibrium complexity, I will come back to this in a second, the equilibrium complexity will be sigma of fg phi t. Okay? There will be a special value of f that corresponds to the typical states that I find if I sample with equilibrium weight. But in general, I will have a curve, and the curve will look like this. There will be a minimum of free energy, and there will be a maximum of free energy. And it's reasonable to expect that if you increase the free energy, you have more states. Okay. But it's not necessarily true. This is. Okay. So this is my assumption. I assume that there is a density of states. And this density is exponential of n, and it defines the complexity. So then I can inject this here. Okay, I can write the sum over alpha. I write it as sum over as integral over f, sum over alpha of delta of f minus f alpha times e to the minus beta n f. I just introduce a delta function in the sum. And then now I can use, so this is my density of states. So this will become an integral over f, but only between f min and f max, which depend on phi and t. I will not write it explicitly. And then I have e to the n sigma of f minus beta f. Okay. So now I can take, as you can see, okay, but n is large, and this is why everything concentrates. So if n is large, then if I take the free energy of the liquid, which is minus t over n times the logarithm, the z of the liquid, this is what? So when n is large, this is a function of f. I do subdelta point over n. I have to maximize this thing. So this will be minus t. So I will put the minus t inside, and I will write it as the minimum. So I multiply by minus t, so I have a minus, and this will change the. So I have a minimum over f inside f min f max of f minus t sigma of f, and f, and this depends on phi and t. Okay, so this is my result, and so what happens? I have to take this minimum. Okay, so the minimum, let's assume that, so I said sigma is a smooth function between f min and f max. So if the minimum for f falls into this range, what I have In order to minimize, I set to zero the derivative. So I have an equation for f, which is d sigma over df equal to 1 over t. Right? I'm taking the derivative respect to f, so I have 1 equal to t d sigma over df. So I have to find the point such that the slope is 1 over t. Okay? And this point is going to be fg. This is the value, the typical value of f in the liquid state. So I will have a certain fg of phi and t. And if if everything is consistent, this fg should be the same fg that I calculated from the Franz Parisi method. Okay. So so you see, the idea is really that you have a distribution of state that is white, because it's exponential of n sigma. So the more you increase sigma, the more states you have. But on the other hand, you have an equilibrium weight that wants to, so depending on the temperature, you want to visit low free energy states. And you have to, so in the resulting distribution is going to be sigma of f, that is a kind of parabola, more or less, minus beta f, that is going to tilt it. So the probability of f, this exponential of this thing, is going to have a strong peak around fg. So it's a large deviation thing again, with width 1 over square root of n. And this is the concentration principle that I was using from the beginning, OK? But the problem, so OK, and then when I change temperature, I will visit different states. And okay, but so you will see next time why I want to use the rare states. But so there are two more things I wanted to say. One is that you see that now this is like when you do equilibrium. When you do equilibrium, full equilibrium, you have energy and entropy. So the energy, you have a term exponential of minus beta times the energy that wants to push the energy down, and you have the entropy that wants to push the energy up. And you have to do the something like that, where here we have E minus T, and you have S of E. So this is a good situation, because then the free energy as a function of T is the Legendre transform of the entropy. So if you want to know the entropy, you just have to invert the thermodynamics, and you get the entropy from the free energy. You have to take the derivative and blah, blah, blah. Fine. Here we have a problem. The problem is that we are not working with energy and entropy. We are working with the free energy of the states. That is something that depends. We are working with the free energy of the states, and then we have the. So we already integrated. If you want, we already integrated a little bit the fluctuations in a state. But and then we want to study the fluctuations. But this thing here depends on temperature. So this looks like that f of t of the liquid is a Legendre transform of sigma with respect to f. So you could say, OK, let's invert the Legendre transform. But if you take a derivative with respect to t, you are going to get sigma, but you also have a term that is the derivative of sigma with respect to t that you don't know. So you cannot invert the Legendre transform. So t, the point is that the temperature is not conjugated to the complexity, because the complexity itself depends on temperature, because it's counting the number of states of free energy f. But if you change the temperature, these states will move, will become a bit bigger or a bit smaller. So you cannot reconstruct the complexity just from this. From this, the only thing we can do is to say that, okay, there is a complexity, and the solution of this equation is going to be the typical states, the free energy of the typical states, and the equilibrium complexity should be equal to sigma of fg, that, by the way, depends on the state point. So for the moment, we didn't gain much. We just identified that there is a distribution of states. There are typical states. And these typical states should coincide with the one we got from Franz Parisi. And the next step so will be to introduce some effective temperature that will be conjugated to the complexity. And so we can really do a Legendre transform and we can reconstruct the complexity. And the last thing I want to say is that, so you see that what's going on when you increase temperature, when you decrease temperature or you increase density, we will see. When you decrease temperature, you are moving the slope down. So at the lower temperature, you are going to get something like this. But you cannot do it forever. At some point, if the slope here is finite, this will be an assumption that will be checked later. But if the slope here is finite, you will reach a temperature, Tk, at which 1 over Tk will be equal to the slope of sigma in the minimum. So this will be the definition of Tk. So at that point, you are trying to push the free energy so low that you get to the minimum. So the complexity will go to zero. So sigma equilibrium will go to zero. That is what we already found. And what happens below that point? If you keep reducing the temperature, you will be stuck in the minimum because you would like to find a solution to this equation at lower, with a bigger slope, but there is nothing with that slope. And since you have to take the minimum in a restricted interval, you will see that the minimum of this function will be always f min. So below the Kauzmann point, what we have to do is to, if we want to keep being in equilibrium, the system will be in the minimum free energy state. So we have to find a way, if we want to study this state that is called the ideal glass, we have to find a way to compute sigma of f at a given state point. And if we are able to compute sigma of f, we can find the point where this sigma of f goes to zero. And this will be the free energy f min, that is the free energy of the ideal glass. So we will be able in this way to complete our phase diagram and get this line. So that's the plan for the next lecture. We will do this, and then we will study a little bit how this result that phi k goes like log d, I will try to put this a little bit into context of the problem of packing spheres in large dimension. And then I would like to study in the last a little bit tomorrow, and probably a little bit in the last lecture, I would like to study this jamming line. What are the properties of this jamming line that Andrea already discussed a lot, but I would like to show you what mean field theory says about this jamming line.
Thank you.
The derivative of the of what of f liquid?
Yeah, f liquid with
no. So if you take the derivative of f liquid with respect to density, you will find the pressure of the liquid.
Yeah, this.
But you will not find this one because because you have to. What you have to do to find this one is the derivative. You want to take the derivative of f min with respect to density. So if you keep. So you will see. I mean, if you try to keep looking at f liquid. F liquid will not realize that there is this transition. It will do an analytic continuation of the liquid phase that formally will have a negative complexity. So the analytic continuation does not realize that there is a singularity, and it tells you, okay, I can go on, but if you try to compute the complexity, you find it's negative. So it's inconsistent.
Yes. Yeah. Okay.
N? Yes, sorry, it's number of particles, which I'm taking to be infinite.
Okay. And
Sorry?
So the green lines that hit the x-axis below jamming, which I...
Ah, no, no, there is one jamming for each glass, so that's the point, sorry. I will stress this a bit later, but the point is that there is really what is called a jamming line, which means if you... So this is something that Ludovic has done very systematically. If you do swap, for example, up to some point, and you are in equilibrium at that point, now you switch off the swap and you compress, you will end up here. If you do swap and you equilibrate a little bit more and you compress, you will end up here, and so on. And in infinite dimension, the range you can explore is divergent, because this is of order d, this is of order 1 in fine, this is of order log d. In 3D, I think, what's the best? You got something like 10% variation density. From 0.6 to 0.7, something like that. No? So you can create in this way jammed packings that have that are all amorphous because they are created by just compression of the liquid. So you cannot see any sign of crystallization, nothing like that. They are all jammed, they are all critical in the sense that Andrea explained, but they have different densities over a range of about 10%.
Is there any real
No, I mean, this is mean field, so this is justified if you believe that you have metastable states that have an infinite lifetime, and so you can really decompose, and the way you decompose is you say, okay, if I start the dynamics here, it will never go out. No, it's not a priori. So you have to try to do the calculation, and again, okay, maybe tomorrow I will discuss this, but what you will see is that you have to introduce a delta. This delta, there will be replicas. This delta will be there will be a distance between replicas. And there will be a kind of Franz Parisi thing. It will be an f of delta, and we will have to look for a local minimum. So the local minimum means that you have a metastable state, and if you are in a finite dimensional system, you never will have the f of delta will be convex. There will be a Maxwell construction, and you will escape the metastable state in a finite time. So. Again, it's an infinite construction. And then how much it's true in finite D depends on how long is the lifetime of your states compared to your experimental time.
Is there a way to compute the complexity instead of along the equilibrium line, along one of the restricted deconstruction of restricted gap?
So, okay, if you are in the blue region, the idea is that each glass remains a glass. So the complexity, if you follow here, then the number of glasses that you have is the same that you have here.
Okay. No, sure.
You mean here?
No, I mean, in the one decimal, you don't count for those...
I think there are two answers. You can ask the question, if I know that here I have exponential of n sigma glasses.
Yeah.
That are all equivalent.
Yeah.
Now I compress each of them to this point.
Yes.
If the replica symmetric thing remains true, they keep being all equivalent,
yeah.
So the number is exactly the same.
Yeah.
When you reach this point, you break the replica symmetry, and then it's complicated. You start to have states inside states, and how to count them is very complicated, because what do you want to count? You want to count the big basins, the small basins, so it's a very open and complex problem. You can ask another question, which is, if I start from here, and I go here, now I am at an atypical state point, that is not where the liquid does not exist, and I went here by following this state. And I can say, how many states are present at this point? If I look to all possible states, and this I will discuss tomorrow, there are more states at this point than the one you can get by doing this. So if you create states by compressing the liquid, in equilibrium you are looking to the typical states, and this is what maximizes the distribution and so on. So these are the typical states. But when you move away from the liquid, your states will become atypical.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, maybe this is anticipating tomorrow, so I will come back on this tomorrow, but we will discuss it. Sorry, there was a
think there is some model, meeting model, that presents the non-convex complexity of the three angles.
Like this? Like this? So yeah, there are models like in constraint satisfaction where it, where you can get things like this.
And also going back, like a first order transition.
Going back, I don't know, Federico, you don't know. I've never seen such thing.
Okay. No,
but
like a first order transition.
I think it's not forbidden, but the zoology, Daniel.
Yeah, forgetting for a second the problem with the dependence of the complexity, it looks to me that solving a settled point equation to that integral there gives us an arbitration principle for beta, actually, for my order. So
what? Repeat the last part? Gives a?
Gives a large deviation principle solving the settled point for that integral there.
No, beta is fixed. We are working at the given state.
What I mean is that I mean, formally solving that with solving a single point for exactly would give us an exponential for an rate function for beta, right? Because we are solving for
let's
that gives us a PDF like the large division principle for the PDF.
Now wait, let's do it in equilibrium, it's very easy. So the partition function is the integral of over dx of e to the minus beta times the energy of x. I'll call it e, but it's v, okay? So if I...
No, right.
So how do I do here? What I do is I write this as integral over...
It's okay.
Let me finish. You can write it in this way, right? So this is the entropy, and then you have to maximize the energy at constant temperature to get the canonical free energy. So it's a variational thing, it's a large deviation for E, and then you can invert it and you can get.
Yeah.
If you continue with the counter transition line to the right, what happens?
I will discuss also this tomorrow, but it will intersect at some point the equilibrium, the ideal glass. But this is not necessary. There are models, for example, in the 1 over to the 12 potential, it's the other way around, it's energy and temperature, but it will finish at some finite. So this is model dependent. But in the case of hard spheres, it will intersect because the important point is that gem states will always be in the Gardner phase. And otherwise, they are not critical. So there is something that induces replica symmetry breaking around the jamming line.
Okay, there are no other questions. Thank you again.